going to head the this episode of the Chirp podcast is going to be a lot of fun as we dive into a part of the game that's always present and always right in front of us, but is kind of in the background, and that's officiating, but with a twist. As Katie Guay joins us, the first female official in the American Hockey League and a longtime referee in and around the hockey circles, but is progressing towards the ultimate goal, and that being in the National Hockey League. And I've done some research, Katie, on you and the background, but I also wanted to leave a lot to just explore where this conversation goes, because there's different paths that we can go around. But where are you right now? What are you doing? Give us an update on your status.
Yeah, sure. First of all, thanks for having me. I love talking hockey, and anytime we can bring light to the officiating side of the game, it's a win-win for all of us. So I appreciate you having me on. I'm currently sitting in my office here in Rhode Island, Warwick, Rhode Island. I work at Squad Locker. It's a tech-led apparel company where we sell uniforms, gear, spirit wear through stores that each team can create on their own on the website. So it's a great way to stay involved in sports, in my 9-to-5 job, and allows me some flexibility to ref on the weekends.
So that's interesting. You have a full-time job, and then the officiating is your passion?
It is.
Okay. So when are you allowed to ditch the 9-to-5 and become a full-time referee?
Whenever the games are scheduled.
That's but your goal is to referee in the National Hockey League?
You know, I've had a lot of goals along the way. My first goal when I started officiating was an international tournament, and I did that in 2010 out in France. And then I set the bar higher, and the goal is the Olympics, and I reached that in 2018, and that's the next year is when I went to a officiating combine up in Buffalo, New York, that the NHL was putting on. So, you know, right now I'm just enjoying the ride and seeing where it will take me.
Do you always have your gear with you, just in case you get that call?
It's in the back of the car.
Right now?
Right now, always.
What was the first time where you did a game where you refereed at a certain level where you thought, geez, I think I could do this at a much higher level?
You know, officiating, it's a roller coaster ride, right? I mean, you leave a game that went pretty well, and the confidence is booming, and you feel like you could take that next leap. And then there are other games that you just want to, you know, jump into a hole somewhere. So it's definitely a ride, and you just have to keep the emotions at a constant, but also learn from your mistakes, but use that confidence to continue growing.
Refereeing's a different career path after you go to play 4 years of college. So was that always on the radar, officiating?
No, never. And actually, I was a bit of a grinder in college. And when my teammates found out I was reffing, you know, something that they didn't believe either. And now I get to ref some of my former teammates, their games, you know, they're behind the benches. So definitely lots of smiles there when I'm wearing the stripes and they're behind the benches. But let's see, my team, I went to Brown University, played 4 years there. And my freshman year, we went to the NCAA tournament up at UNH. We were in the finals, and in the semifinals, we played Minnesota. And I was a grinder, a third line player. My job was really just to get the puck deep and get off for the scores to get out there. And, you know, I had a pretty big open ice hit, just laid somebody out, and it wasn't really the intention, but, you know, I was just out there making sure they didn't get in our zone. And, that play ended up being on the following year's NCAA rules video. So pretty ironic that after that I jumped in the stripes, but it was just another way to stay involved in the game. When I graduated, there really weren't many opportunities to continue playing, and I loved the game and wanted to be part of it. It was just another way to stay on the ice and be in the action.
What would you have been like if you were officiating yourself as a player?
Good question. I wasn't a chirper, so I think in that sense, I usually knew when I was guilty and just skated right to the box. So in that sense, I think officials probably didn't dislike me too much out there, but I did get my fair share of penalties. But, you know, I think I knew I was guilty when the action happened. So I think, you know, as an official, as long as, you know, people don't cause too much ruckus after the call, I think it's in the spirit of the game overall.
What would Katie Guay, the player, think of Katie Guay, the official? Call the game too tight or loose?
Oh, yeah, maybe calling a little too tight out there.
Yeah. What's your approach to every game? Or do you have a philosophy of how you approach every game?
You know, at the end of the day, our job is to call a fair, consistent game. And so the hope is that over the course of the 60 minutes, we're calling it consistently. And I find the biggest compliment after a game is when the coach of the losing team says, great game. And so I think that shows a huge amount of respect and, for those that generally mean it, I think that's a great nod of confidence that we called the game to the rule book and consistently and fair both ways.
No, you said for those that generally mean it, you mean there's coaches that say good game, but they don't make eye contact and they just walk off?
What are you talking about?
I have no idea. I didn't had no clue that actually happened. Your first game in the American Hockey League, how nervous were you?
You know, I've been in some big games throughout my career, and it really wasn't until the week prior when my phone just started blowing up. For me, it was another game, obviously at a different level, but felt pretty prepared for the steps I had taken up until that point. And then once the texts and the outreach and the calls came in and just continued to come in until puck drop, that's when I realized the significance of that game. Wes McCauley, Steve Barton, a bunch of guys from the AHL, veterans of the league, had reached out to me. And so hearing from all those folks, then, you know, I think that's when the nerves definitely picked up a little more, knowing there were a few extra eyes on the game that night. So, getting to the rink and having a few extra people in the arena that aren't typically around, made that game that much more a bit of a pressure cooker. But certainly once that first puck went down, it was another hockey game and just out there, doing what I had prepared to do up until that point.
Should have asked at the start of this, like, do referees get nervous?
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely that adrenaline flowing. And that's one of the things I tell people, who are interested in getting officiating. It's that same adrenaline flow as a player. You're out there in the action. You're on the goal line looking, at a scrum of eight players in front of the net. And there's definitely that adrenaline flowing when the crowd's into it. It's definitely a lot of fun. And, the energy is there for sure.
Who's the first player you ever teed up in the American Hockey League, or have you?
So far.
Really? You haven't yet?
So far, yeah. We'll have to talk another next time.
What's the player's reaction?
Overall, it's been, they've been very respectful. I think anytime someone's in stripes, there's definitely a lot of chirping and words to be said after every call, it seems like. But, as far as me being a little different than what I'm used to seeing, I think I've seen nothing but respect out there on the ice.
I got to be careful how I phrase this. But if they're just yelling at you, like, is that a compliment? They're just yelling at you for a bad call? It doesn't matter, man, woman?
Yeah, for sure. My goal at the end of the day is to be treated just like my peers. And so I wouldn't want anyone to be treating me differently because of my gender. And so I think, yeah, having a little chirping after calls is normal. And, I think for them to be treating me just like everyone else is a sign of respect.
Do you get to pick your number when you go into the American Hockey League or the NHL?
No.
No?
No, and I started with one number, which I definitely took a lot of smack for, but I was handed that number and wore it for some time, and then was given another number once my size jersey came in.
Oh, is that why you switched numbers?
Yeah, so okay, I was...
Explain to people.
I'm now number 25, but I did not start out as number 25 my first few games, so...
What was the number that you started with?
the same number that I wore in Mini Mites when I first started playing, the number of the great one.
Because that was the first picture I saw. I'm like, that's confidence. If you do get to pick your number, and you're not trying to blend in.
Nope, not at all. No, anyone wearing that number on the ice is not blending in. No, I was handed that number, and it was the jersey, the only jersey I had heading to Wilkes-Barre that day. So so I threw it on and, went with it.
Okay. How do numbers work with officials?
Well, I've been given two so far, and one was on one end of the spectrum, and then the other one is a little bit on the lower end. Typically, referees wear the lower numbers of.
Oh, they do. Okay, I didn't know that. It's perfect. And, but you don't pick your number in the NHL in the American League. It's just purely assigned.
I was assigned a number. I'm not sure. Okay. I'm not sure how it all works, and if certain people get to choose if they're provided with open numbers.
What's the best perk about being a referee?
A front row seat to the greatest game on earth.
Do you like being neutral zone or O-zone?
Being on that goal line, it's a lot of fun out there. You're in the action. But then in the neutral zone, you get a little bit of a broader view of the ice. It switches, I'd say, over the course of the game. You're probably in both positions 50-50 because we're just shifting up and down the ice. So, you get different perspectives of the game.
Are you a stoic official or are you one of those chatty officials?
There's
a lot of thought going into this answer.
I would like to say I'm chatty, but even as a player, I was just never good with the one-liners. So I'm usually... right to the point, and you just state the facts out there is typically how I like to give it.
You call a minor penalty, you go to a TV timeout, and you're standing there by the timekeeper's bench, and the players' doors open, and they want to chat back and forth, and maybe it's a little hot. Do you engage in that, or are you one to separate yourself? I'm going right at the player and giving it to them, but I'm curious about your reaction.
It's mixed, right? Sometimes they're literally just asking how they could have done things differently. And so in that scenario, you just explain what you saw, explain the action that they took and why the penalty was called. And then there are other times where, it gets a little elevated. In that case, you try to calm them down a little bit, which, is tough to do in that situation.
Never
but,
happens.
you can't back down. Certainly, there's two sides of every story, and the call was made for a reason. So it's just explaining to them why it was made, and if they want to believe it, great. If not, on to the next play.
I'm always blown away by how much interaction verbally there is between officials and players. Like officials do talk a lot out there.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of chatter out there, and I think every league's a little bit different. This year in the American Hockey League, I've come to realize that, some of it's cordial, it's just reactionary, and there is definitely a lot of chatter after, it seems like, every call out there, and I think everybody's trying to get whatever edge they can. It's all part of it, but it's our job to make the calls and hopefully just be consistent throughout the course of the game and the season.
You've done men's and women's. Which side chirps you more? Which players chirp you more?
Good question. I think everyone enjoys chirping when they're on the ice. So
yeah. You're not going either side of that that answer.
Nope. I take it from all angles.
when you get to the rink, what do you do? Like, give me a walkthrough of an official's preparation. I've seen it, but I'm curious about maybe your routine before you go into a game.
So, depending if I've worked with the person or the other officials before or not, that sometimes that changes the dynamics a little bit just because you're trying to understand different people's styles on the ice. And, you go over, you look at the stat sheets that are there and just talk about past games that you've had with the teams and, just try to figure out, what the temperature will be on the ice for that game. And then there's that off ice preparation to warm up physically, and then that mental
sprints?
Preparation.
Do you do the ladder? Do you do sprints? What does the referee do?
Just a combo of each, a little ladder, high knees, just making sure we're loose out there, and then just getting mentally prepared. I work out of multiple rule books, so it's just making sure that night I know which rule book I'm working out of, and making sure that we're all on the same page.
Have you ever made a mistake with the wrong rule book?
Have I ever made a mistake?
No, sorry, but you know, like working one league where the rules are different than another league, and because you mentioned the different rule books, and I had that written down as one of the challenges that you have, right? If you're a full-time NHL referee, that's your thing, and you might do an Olympics every now and then, but you can kind of get your head around it. But you're working differently. You might do two leagues in 3 days.
Yeah, you definitely have to trust your partners out there, and I always, let them know that I'm typically working on multiple rule books, and you know who you can rely on when you're out there. But definitely, you don't want to make those mistakes more than once, and that's something I tell rookies when they're first starting out is, I made hundreds, thousands of mistakes when I first started out, and when I had a journal. And so initially I would write down every game. I'd write a couple mistakes that I made because, as officials, our practices are our games. And so you start at various levels. And the hope was that every time I wrote down a mistake, my goal was if I didn't keep making the same mistake over and over, I would eventually, improve. And so I tried not making that same mistake. So to answer your question, at some point I've definitely, crossed over the rule books, and you make that mistake once, and then you try to never do that again. And so it's just, making sure that there's a mental preparation leading up to the game. I know when I was working IHF tournaments, the whole plane ride over the lake, over the pond, I would open up that IHF rule book and read it cover to cover, because I was only working that rule book one tournament a year. And so, it's just a matter of diving into the different rule books and knowing in different rinks what rules you're playing that night.
Is Canada USA women's the most intense hockey you've ever worked?
That does get intense.
Yeah.
That rivalry is fun for sure.
When you said that you would keep the journal and you would try to stop making a mistake multiple times, give me an idea of what that mistake would be that you would eventually improve on. And I'm a total layman when it comes to refereeing, so I apologize if some of these are simple questions.
Oh wow, yeah. I mean, where do I start? When you're lining, when do you put your arm up for a delayed offsides? I think that was the first one one summer league when I, was first putting on the whistle. USA Hockey, a hit from behind, a 2 and 10 or major game. And so, you can't just call a minor in that situation. So, you do that once and you get slapped on the wrist and you don't make that mistake again. So just knowing the rules, the various penalties within each rule, what you can dish out, and every league's a little bit different there. So just knowing the differences is huge.
I'm going to put you on the spot here because I legitimately don't know the answer here. Don't be too nervous because I talked to some people and I'm not sure anybody really knows the answer to this. I worked a game last night, Vegas against Vancouver, and Bo Horvat took a faceoff and he lost it cleanly to William Karlsson, who won it back, and Alec Martinez accidentally tipped the puck into his own net. So Bo Horvat's the offensive player. He never touches the puck and it goes in the net. Who gets credit for that goal? I've heard closest player. I've heard player taking the face off. In the NHL, referees don't even make that call, right? It's the official scorer that makes the call, but I don't know.
Yeah, usually it's the last player to touch the puck.
Yeah, that was simple. But then I looked at it and nobody touched the puck. What are we going with here? And I can't, I've talked to all different people around the league, and I'm not going to throw anybody out there for to be highlighted, but nobody can really tell me the answer if no player touches the puck.
Yeah, the stats crews can argue over that one.
There, that is the right answer. That is a veteran official referee right there in Katie Guay. Where have you improved the most as an official over the last couple of years as you try to get to that ultimate level?
Well, my senior year of college, I'd always played forward, and I think we had a couple D go down, and my coach said, all right, you're playing D for your last game senior year. And I was like, but I don't know how to skate backwards. And she said, well, skate forwards. I said, all right, here we go. Officiating, I did a lot of the three man international tournaments for a while, and then eventually it switched to the four man. And so from the three man, you're skating end to end, goal line to goal line, and then four man, you're covering half the ice, but most of the time you're skating backwards. And so I think that was a huge transition when all the leagues switched over from the three man to the four man, is from the forward skating to the backward skating. And so I think my skating has definitely improved over the years, being forced to work on my backward skating, utilizing the edge work is something that I've been working on over time. We're out there for the full 60 minutes on the ice skating, and skating is a huge part of our game. And that's something that I've been working on and continue to work on. And I think, that's an area that's continued to improve.
Where do you work on your edge work? Do you rent ice? Do officials rent ice on their own? Do they go public skating? Because you don't have practices like players do where they have free ice just available.
So I've gone to development camps for, various USA Hockey, IHF. And it's so funny when the officials do have an ice session and there are 20 or 30 of us out there with our sweaters on, watching people walk through the rink, watching 30 officials skate around. Their faces are priceless. But so there's camps, development camps. But then also in the summer, a group of us in my area will jump on the ice at 5 or 6 a.m. before the summer camps start up, and do 45 hour of power skating drills. So literally just get on the goal line or start in the corner, and we're just working on edge work and just getting an hour sweat in. And it's a huge, huge help for endurance, but also skating and edge work, getting those reps throughout the summer.
Do you have an Apple Watch?
I'm currently wearing a Whoop.
Oh, you're fancy. That you're big league. I aspire to be that. People will set it for ice hockey or whatever, and see how many calories they burn in a game. How many calories do you burn?
I haven't actually tracked it.
Will you let me know, please?
I will. Or how many miles I've covered, I'll let you know. Yeah, I'm sure it's up there.
I'm fascinated by it. What the difference would be between a bike ride or just going out and playing pickup, and how many calories you'd burn. That's kind of in the range of 600 to 700 in a pickup game by the Apple Watch and what your heart rate is. But as an official, you have no idea how many miles you would skate out there?
No, that's a good question, though. And now I'm a little curious.
See, that we knock down all the barriers here. We go into places you'd never ever thought of. And on barriers, what was it like being the first female to work that American Hockey League game?
It was really an honor. I think I was in the right place at the right time. Certainly, I think there are a few women ahead of me that had the ability to be in that place, and the timing just wasn't right for them. So certainly feel as though I did it for many of those that came before me who might not have had the chance. But then also for all the others who might now set this as their goal. I never thought men's pro hockey was a possibility. So it was never something I had my sights set towards or really a goal for. But once that first officiating combine opened its doors to the women, I realized that there were other paths for officials out there. And that's when I realized that, you know, I could set this goal for myself and see where it will take me.
How many games have you done in the AHL?
Half a dozen or so.
And fun, challenging, different?
Yeah, definitely all of the above. You know, a lot of energy from the crowd, certainly a fast game. You know, they move hard. They move out there. They hit hard. So they're a lot of fun to be out there with.
Do you think you can work the National Hockey League?
We'll see. One game at a time, right? You know, I think every game I do out there, I'm learning and growing, and getting those reps in is a huge help. So, you know, building that confidence at any level is really important as you work your way up. So, you know, I'm taking it one game at a time and just enjoying the ride while I'm on it.
Well, you're hard to nail down here on certain areas of trying to get a definitive answer. How many, do you have a timeline at what it might take now that you've done a half dozen games? Would you have to work 2 years in the American Hockey League, 4 years in the American Hockey League? You ready now?
I don't have a timeline. I know my path to the Olympics was about an 8-year journey. So I don't know. I don't know if it'll take, you know, that long to see a female out there. I'm not sure. You know, I think every game is a test and you need to perform and, you know, do well out there. And I think that's how any official moves forward.
Do you watch the NBA and see female officials out there? National Football League has it now.
Yeah. Yeah. One went to the Super Bowl last year.
So how does that make you feel?
You know, I think it's amazing. I was at Providence. I did the P. Bruins yesterday. And to see the amount of little girls in the stands, it's incredible. I grew up in Western Massachusetts and my brother played hockey. I have a sister that played hockey and I just followed in their footsteps and really never thought anything of it. I was the only girl on my team, often the only girl in my league. And so it wasn't until junior high that my locker room got moved from the team locker room into the public bathroom. And I think that's when I realized that, oh, you know, is this really the game for me? But I continued playing with the boys through ninth grade and then switched over to Deerfield Academy, where I went to prep school and had my first chance to play with the girls. And, you know, back then there were very few girls in the stands. I used to go to Springfield Indians games as a kid, and the amount of girls in the stands was a lot less than it is today. So to be in that rank yesterday and just look around to see all the girls in the stands, the game is growing. As you see in the US Canada game, the quality on ice has just come so far in the last couple decades, and more girls are playing. And so I think to be in that position and to open the eyes of these little girls to realize that there are just so many opportunities out there for them is makes it all worth it and makes me want to keep getting out there.
What do you say to people who yell at the ref when they get in the way of a pass or a shot or a body?
It's funny because I feel like I'll be honest with you with this one. In the women's game,
I wore her down. I wore her down.
You did. It took a little bit, but here we go. I feel as though in the women's game, we get shot at with a puck. A lot of the times it's get the F out of the way. And in the guys' game, a lot of times it's an apology.
Really?
So I think in that scenario, the guys are a little more understanding that, you know, they weren't aiming at us, but they accidentally hit us, and it's more on them with their aim. And so, you know, we're wearing some equipment out there, but not a ton.
Not a lot, no.
I mean, it hurts. Yeah. It hurts to get hit out there. And so we're never trying to get in the way. And that's what I wish players would understand, is that we're not out there jumping into the way of pucks. We try to get as far away as possible, but sometimes, you know, we just don't anticipate as we should. And, you know, we're in the firing territory, but, you know, our goal out there is definitely not to get hit with pucks. And so, you know, that is one difference I'll share with you.
I was watching Dallas and Anaheim last week, and it was at the end of a delayed penalty, and the player shot the puck just down the ice along the wall. I don't know whether you saw this.
I did.
Yeah, and it hit the linesman. I was impressed.
It was a penalty.
And I was so impressed that the linesman, just when he got helped up, patted the player on the head for saying, I know you didn't mean it, but the player legitimately shot the puck and hit the linesman. I would have snapped. Like, there's that player doesn't play again in my lifetime. But the level of empathy and understanding from the officials in that group, and no penalty was called off it.
Yeah.
Take me inside that world. You saw that?
Yeah. It was definitely a frustration reaction by the player, but you know, yeah, I mean, we try to keep everyone's tempers down out there, and obviously sometimes like that, you know, situations like that, escalating it isn't going to help the situation at all. And yeah, a lot of respect to those officials out there, especially the one who got smoked in the knee with the puck from a fairly close range there. Definitely kudos to him for his reaction there.
Do you follow scoutingtheref.com and scouting the ref on Twitter?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. A little bit.
A little, is that, is that an ability that you can get better, or is it just to keep up to date with stuff going on and who's working which games? Because I follow just to see patterns.
Yeah, I like to see who's working, mm-hmm. track that. Now that I've gotten to know some of the guys, it's fun to see who's where and follow their games.
It's kind of cool that referees have their own sort of pseudo game day, who's working, starting goalies, starting assignments, and all that kind of stuff. Their own community.
We have to cheer for each other, right? Who else is out there cheering for us?
If you could work one game with anybody as your official partner, who's that person?
Oh, that's a tough one. You know,
I'm not serving softballs up here, Katie.
I already gave you a tough answer. You know, I've crossed paths with so many amazing people, and that's why so many of us stay involved as long as we do. Just, it's, you know, the camaraderie that we have, the fun, the road trips, the miles that we log together, you know, it's just a fun ride. It's something that we try to share with those players that are going to hang them up in the near future, because eventually everyone's playing careers come to an end, and officiating is just another great way to stay involved in the game. And so, you know, the friends that we make along the way and the great stories that we get to share. There's so many great officials out there that I would pick.
I worked a charity game on the lines with Don Van Massenhoven. He was awesome. Like Van Mass. Have you met Donnie?
No, I haven't.
Okay. He's just a pure beauty, and he's just awesome. Stephen Walkham. I would love to work with Stephen because he never stops talking. So I think it would be, it would be so entertaining.
So don't you think we should get headsets out there to talk to each other? Like that soccer?
That would be great. Why don't we have that?
I don't know. I'm wondering the same thing.
Now, when you do IIHF or Olympics, don't they have the?
Yeah, just for announcements.
Oh, like it is
NHL. Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah. Trying to think of who else over the years, but like a longtime referee. Is there anybody that you said it would have been nice to work with him?
Oh, there's so many. I don't know.
Come on.
There's a lot out there. There's a lot. I would definitely pull back some of my mentors too, who showed me the ropes and got me to where I am. And, you know, to have another game with some of those folks would be great.
I'm blanking on the name, so Bob, help me out here. Mustache, worked in Olympic final, longtime NHL official. He works in the situation room now, helps out in the situation room, always flipped up the puck before every game, would do this. And that was a nod to his daughter. Before he did a big game or his first game, he flipped up the puck to tell his daughter that that he was thinking of her before he dropped the puck, and just had just an awesome career. And I think he did the 2002 Olympic men's final back then. So that was where he came on my radar, and just a stud of a referee. That was one. Do you have any rituals before you do a game like that? Do you have any types of patterns?
You know, I try not to have any superstitions just because there's so many variables out there that I, you know, don't want to get caught up in those events that can take your focus off the game. So no, I wouldn't say.
Bill McCreary is the other person that I was just talking about. So Van Mass for sure. Bill McCreary would have been awesome. That I would have loved to have worked with.
So you wear the stripes?
Well, I just helped out. I refereed as a kid, and it was fun. And here's the thing, I think if you reach like U14, every player, boy, girl,
and coach.
Should take a referee's course. It should be mandatory. And
try it one game.
For sure. And professional, no brainer. But I can't believe that we don't have that type of thing in Canadian or USA hockey.
I agree with you. And there's a huge shortage right now at the youth level. And I think that every, you know, 14 to 18 year old should be refing the younger kids.
Yes.
Of their league. And that way you get a sense of that side of the game. Hopefully parents understand that these are kids out there reffing their kids. And, you know, there's a bit of a respect factor that could be built into it, but for just to see sight lines.
Yeah.
I think just to see the game from a different perspective, I wish I had started it when I was playing. I think it would have made me a better player, and really smart players will try to use officials as picks down low. And so, you know, obviously we don't want to be used as a pick, but really smart players I notice will try to do that.
I just moved to the slot, and that way I'm totally out of the way along the boards and in that area. Hey, I'm also blown away how many players don't know the rules.
Yeah.
I have no clue on different things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You're right there.
Listen, see, you're too good. You're absolutely amazing the way you handle all this stuff. Do you like doing this type of thing, doing the interviews, or would you rather just kind of fly under the radar?
I don't know. You want to switch spots? Because it seems like you enjoy the whistle.
That's really good. Did you save your jersey from your first American Hockey League game? Did you get to keep that one?
I had to turn that one in.
Get out of here.
Yeah. So I think it may have headed north.
Oh, Hall of Fame?
That was what I was told.
It's okay to admit your sweater's in the Hall of Fame. Like, it's not a bad thing.
it's apparently there. I don't know. I haven't been up there this year to see it.
Katie Guay's jersey in the Hall of Fame. Won't talk about it. Okay. let's wrap it up there. This has just been a cool experience, but... if you see yourself in 4 years, what are you doing?
I don't know. You just gave me the invite to be on that side of the stage.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Let's do that.
You know, I don't know. Honestly, you know, if you had asked me when I first got into it, I didn't know where the game would take me. And my goal was just to keep improving back then. And was able to reach a bunch of goals. So now I have, you know, an Olympics under my belt, a couple women's NCAA championship games under my belt. And those were all goals that my mentor had, Julie Piacentini, she achieved those goals. And my goal was to follow her path. And you know, I was able to do that. And now I just love being part of the game and you know, all these other opportunities. In 2019, I get to go out to California to be part of the NHL Prospect Games out there in Anaheim. And
yeah,
I had to pinch myself. Never in my wildest dreams did I think I would be out in OC officiating an NHL prospect tournament. So, you know, I never, you know, had you asked me 4 years prior to that, never imagined it was possible. So I really don't know where the game will take me, but at this time, you know, having done some AHL games this year, it's been a heck of a ride and I've enjoyed it and, you know, excited to see what lies ahead.
Like, so many people plan out every day, every week, every month. And here you are just freewheeling life. I want to be you. Like, I do. I want this attitude where it's just freewheeling and no, like, it doesn't sound like you have any real pressure or expectations.
No. And also when I was out in OC, we had a day off in between games and I was able to get on the Price is Right while I was out there. A childhood dream.
Did you make it up to the stage?
Oh yeah. Drew Carey.
Got to get out of here. Mm-hmm. No. Yeah. What'd you win? What'd you do?
Well, to get up on stage, I won a lovely state-of-the-art turntable.
What did you bid?
I think it was like I bid 813 because I was trying to throw the guy off next to me who was just going one over every bid for the first three rounds. And here we were in round four and I was the first one up to the stage. Yeah. Up to the, you know, of the four, I was the first one up there and we went through in the guy next to me and we went through the first half of the show and neither of us went up there. And we were like, uh-oh, like we can't be the first two up here or have our names called first and then not actually get up there.
Are you guys chatting during the commercial break about that?
Like, yeah. Hey, oh, yeah. Yeah. The pressure was on at that point for round two. And so then I was like, all right, he's just bidding $1 more of everything I say. So I need to just throw him off. And I bid like 813 and then he bid 819 and it ended up being 818. Crazy.
That's amazing.
So a turntable is now sitting in my parents' kitchen. Yeah.
That will never be thrown out.
No.
Ever.
No.
And,
no.
And then when you went up, what game did you play?
So during the interview process, which is an all day affair, I watched it with my grandmother all growing up. And then I hadn't seen the show in a while. And we were trying to think of what shows or what games that were on the show. And I was like, oh, the putting game. I love the putting game. But if you've ever seen my golf game, you would not really not think that that's my favorite game on The Price is Right. And so during the interview process, I said that the putting game was my favorite game. And lo and behold, what game did I get? The putting game. But you need to choose five or six items that they introduced to you.
Yeah.
But you can't hear anything when you're on stage because the crowd is screaming and you're on stage as they're explaining the items that you have to price in order from lowest to highest. And it was a pack of five wipes, but one of them, the bean dip, is when I just completely blew it on. So I had to putt from the furthest line back, which, you know, Drew Carey gave me the mic. I held the mic. He showed me how to do it. And obviously it goes right in. I get up there. I banked it off the back wall. And then it came back and like just skimmed it by like a couple centimeters. And then my next one, I just shanked like I always do when I'm on the course. So unfortunately, that Kia is not what I went to the rink in after that.
You have a picture of you dropping a puck in an NHL game, and you have a picture of you beside Drew Carey in The Price is Right. Which picture gets the higher, better location?
Oh, I don't know. They're both right up there.
That is awesome. I did not know. What a trip.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, you talk about 4 years from now, who knows where I'll be.
Do you second guess yourself more about a game? Do you second guess yourself more about a game that you do or what you did in The Price is Right? I should have done that.
Oh, well, yeah, I know. I definitely lose sleep over both. So I don't know.
So you can't hear what the crowd's saying when they're giving you the encouragement?
The announcer introduces the items that you have to bid on. And that's more just right into the TV sound system. I was standing on stage next to Drew while the audience was cheering and I didn't even know what items I was bidding on.
See, I started this whole podcast episode by saying I did a bit of research, but I don't know where the conversation's going to go.
And this, here we are.
This sums it up right here. Hey, Katie.
Have your pet spayed and neutered.
Well, I have three cats, three dogs, two cats, and a guinea pig. So that makes sense. If you're in Vegas, make sure you let me know and we'll get out and we'll have some fun, okay?
All right, red or black?
Now you're asking questions. That's good. I'm going red.
All right.
Red. I'm going red.
All right.
This has been super cool. And I can't wish you more great thoughts and best wishes to you. And I love the background that you've got going there. What's the company again? So we give it proper.
Squad Locker.
Squad
Team
Locker.
Apparel.
Okay, squadlocker.com.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I'm going there right after this. Support Squad
good.
Locker and Katie Guay. And be nice to your official and get your pets spayed and neutered. Thanks, Katie.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate you having me.
Well, we do it every night when we watch a hockey game. So do it with this podcast. What do you do when you watch a hockey game? You either you like, you subscribe, or you rate the referees. Very rarely do you like the referees, but you certainly rate them and you're following the game. So do that with this podcast. Like, subscribe, rate. And you know, if you're watching on YouTube, what a cool background Katie had over at where she's putting in the 9-to-5 work. But if you're watching on YouTube, at the bottom, chirp along with us. Let us know what you think. That was a super cool conversation. Wes McCauley is probably the biggest name right now with what he does during the announcements. I don't see Katie as quite that expressive when she's doing a fighting. But we'll see. When she makes the National Hockey League and we have her back on for round two, she'll spill all the beans to that stuff that she was walking the fine line with. Congratulations to the Florida Panthers, first team to qualify for the Stanley Cup playoffs. Just so happens that Andrew Burnett was on the podcast last week with John Shannon, two different interviews in that. So gets the chirp bump right into the Stanley Cup playoffs. That's why people want to come on this program and participate with the Chirp podcast with Daren Millard. So Bruno was so cool out there in our meeting, and his favorite answer, I said, what about goaltending? Like, you're starting goaltenders, you're pulling goaltenders, like, what do you know? He's like, I don't have a clue. Like, it was just so honest. It was great. And Jared Spurgeon, a couple of weeks ago, Minnesota's on a heater right now. So you're starting to see a trend here. Minnesota, Jared Spurgeon on the Chirp podcast, heater. Listen to that interview. He was really forthcoming about what happens when players are acquired. What's his role as captain? What's Dean Evason like on the bench when he's mumbling under his breath and those lips are moving and after a bad play or a bad call? Listen to that. Go back and listen to that episode and the Andrew Burnett one. So if you based on Minnesota being on a heater because Spurgeon was on the Chirp, Burnett qualifies for the Stanley Cup playoffs because he was on the Chirp. That means Katie Guay is probably going to work the Stanley Cup final this year. Just the way it's working out. Like, subscribe, and rate. And we'll be back with you inside of a month to go in the National Hockey League season. We're working our way towards the playoffs here on the Chirp Podcast with Daren Millard. Peace out.